everyone, and welcome to our newest interview. Today we're accompanied by one-of-a-kind guest. Currently playing to packed houses at the Adelphi Theatre, every night he steps into one of the most memorable characters in film and now theatre history, as he has originated the main role in the musical adaptation of the emblematic 80s movie Back to the Future. All the way from the West End, or should we say Hill Valley, it's the amazing Olly Dobson.
Hey, hey, how's it going?
Really well. So first of all, congratulations on such an amazing show. I think that, you know, it must be staggering to be in such a great production every night, because I saw it last Thursday and it was remarkable, really remarkable.
Yeah, it's easily the biggest and, you know, my opinion, the best thing that I've ever been involved in. I'm going to be eternally grateful for this opportunity that has come my way to play such an iconic role that people know and love. And yeah, like I said, I will forever be grateful to everyone that gave me the opportunity to do this. And yes, it's tons of fun every single night.
Mm-hmm. Now that you mention, as I said, it's such an iconic character, and many people, you know, many members of the audience already know that character. They have grown very fond of it. But this is a new adaptation. So how, you know, as an actor, how do you take the challenge of originating a character that many people know, and you sort of have to give the people what they want, but at the same time, you have to make that character your own? How do you approach that as an actor?
So luckily for me, you know, I have the film mm-hmm. to go off, which is the one thing that everyone knows, and it's the only thing that people know about Marty McFly. You know, the source material is Back to the Future, the movie. And one of the most exciting things for me was not only honing in on paying homage to Michael J. Fox and his performance. I watched the film many times, you know, years ago when I got the job. You know, I've seen the film so many times anyway. But when I got the job, I thought, do you know what? I'm going to write down a list of the things that I remember about Marty McFly. Mm-hmm. And then what I did was, is I watched the film. And as I was watching the film, I was not only ticking the things that I'd already written down, you know, watching the film and going, oh, his voice, you know, I remember that. And, oh, he likes to walk backwards a lot. That's another thing. I also, you know, crossed them out if I thought I was wrong, mm-hmm. going off what I thought. I also wrote down new ones as well. And then at the end, I had accumulated a list of things that I thought people might love to see. Mm-hmm. And that was off of memory. Mm-hmm. So then what happened was, is that I got into the rehearsal room, and you know, your director tells you what to do in certain cases. So sometimes that might go against what was in the film. Mm-hmm. You know, whether that's right or wrong, we don't know. There never is. But you know, with respect to John Rando, you know, of course I'm going to try and give everything I can to the notes that I get given, the direction I get given. Mm-hmm. And the funny thing is, this is easily my favorite question I always get asked. And I wanted to pay enough respect to Michael J. Fox, mm-hmm. myself, and the new guys that didn't even know the film. Mm-hmm. You know, we've had people in that haven't seen it, which is obviously amazing to say that. It's like, what? How have you not seen the film?
Totally. Mm-hmm.
But just to, as an actor, to put your own thing on, such an iconic thing already, that's a dream. Mm-hmm. That is incredible, because, you know, you think, oh my God, I'm adding to this thing. Is that okay? Should I be doing this? Mm-hmm. And yeah, it ended up being so much fun creating this role again, if you will, mm-hmm. co-creating it, because I always think I've done it secretly with Michael, even though we've never been in the same room together.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, it was more about seeing, and it was more about thinking what people wanted. And then when I got into the audition room, I'm so sorry.
It's fine.
Well, that might happen a couple of times.
Yeah.
So basically, yeah, I thought about what Michael was, Marty. Mm-hmm. I watched it and I correlated the notes. Mm-hmm. And then I did a fresh set of lists. I put that all together and I tried to basically play bingo.
Mm-hmm. Very.
I essentially tried to do as many things as I could.
Yeah.
And further into rehearsals we got, I realized, don't need that, don't need that. Definitely need this. And it changed again when I opened in Manchester. You know, I thought, yeah, don't do that, do this, and so on and so on. And I can happily say, since press night, well, that would be a lie. There are still things that I change and add all the time.
Mm-hmm.
7 months into a run, and it's so much fun. And I love that I've been given the chance to play all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But the main focus is always to tell the story.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we do every single night. I don't ever do anything to change it up just for me. I do it if it feels right in that moment. And yeah, the one thing I would say is that I do sound like him on stage. I feel like that was the most important thing people wanted. Yeah. And I think I might have been right with that one.
Mm-hmm.
I think I might have been right.
But talking about, you know, those things that are right and those things that are wrong, are those just a feeling that you have, or do you also benefit from the feedback that you get from the audience? Do you sometimes consider, well, what I'm doing maybe doesn't have the response that I wanted, and that is why I decided to change the approach in the character?
I think it's sort of, I mean, if I were to put it into terms of laughter, you know, oh, this line didn't get as much of a laugh as I thought it would do. Mm-hmm. Let me change it to get the laugh. There aren't many cases where I want to do that. I would much rather it naturally happen.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I see what you're saying, but I usually don't let the audience's reaction drive change in me. Because sometimes I find that might be from an actor's perspective, oh, where's my laugh? I'm going to change it for me to get a laugh.
Mm-hmm.
There might be a couple of moments that I've done that where it might be like a silly noise that he makes in reaction to something.
Mm-hmm.
But generally speaking, what we've set and what we set a long time ago, it kind of stays.
Kind of stays. And now that you say, you know, a long time ago, in this case with Marty McFly, for you, it really has been a long time ago, because you were in the rehearsal room during the workshops at the Dominion Theatre, then you went to play the character in Manchester, then in London. It's been a huge process until, you know, you arrived to the Adelphi Theatre. How has it been, you know, to create a character from the very inception? During the you know, the workshop process, how was, for example, the workshop process? How different was Marty McFly, your Marty McFly, at that moment that it is, you know, today, currently, and also in Manchester?
So in all the workshop versions we did,
mm-hmm.
and I can't even tell you how many we did now. It was a few years ago. I think we did three. I can't remember. In the workshops, the very first one, I was essentially a very, 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 the closest version I could have got to Michael J. Fox. You know, I only did one audition for this. And, you know, at the time they said, you know, it's only going to be for 2 weeks, no guarantee. But the way I looked at it is that I thought that those 2 weeks are going to be my auditions. 2 weeks of auditions. So that was the mentality I went into the room with. And in the workshops, I was very much helping everyone in the creative process of how do we do this?
Mm-hmm.
Here's a version of what we think he'll be. So I brought to the table my impersonation, my version of Marty McFly. And I think for me, that helped with Roger Barr and Hugh Coles and Rosie in scenes when we're doing it together, just to get it up on its feet. But the further we went through, the further we went on in different workshop processes, all the way up until Manchester, we realized that there's scope here to put your own spin on it. So yeah, basically what I would say would be is that at the top I started with essentially a very, not a spitting image, but Michael J. Fox's Marty, who most people love and everyone loves. And that filtered through. And it's a weird one, right? I didn't expect this to happen, but we got to Manchester and, I'm not quite Michael J. Fox anymore. I've got my own spin on it. Mm-hmm. Lockdown happened and I made a very conscious effort, decision to not look at the script, mm-hmm. not watch the film. I had to take myself away from it because I didn't know when we were going to come back.
All right.
Mentally, I didn't want to get myself excited or upset, all that nonsense. And basically, when I came back to London, it was like my body had lost parts of the muscle memory. It was a blessing in disguise because my homage to Michael J. Fox was always there and is and what will always be there. I've watched this film for all of my life. He's always going to be there in the mannerisms and the way in which I speak. But what happened physically and listening wise is that I was able to respond with Marty's character, but actively do it differently. Mm-hmm. Because I had so much time for my body to not purge itself of the memory of my version of Marty in Manchester, but it enabled change. It enabled me to work differently and play a lot more. And I think that really helped. It really helped build another layer to Marty McFly, my version of him anyway. And I am weirdly grateful for the lockdown. Mm-hmm. Obviously a terrible, terrible thing that happened, but in terms of having the time to just not really sit on it and then come back and be like full pelt again, I was discovering things I never would have found before. And that enabled me as an actor to generally allow myself to not be so in on my work all the time. Mm-hmm. It allows me to be fresher when I'm on stage every day. And, I'm incredibly lucky to have this much time to create something like this. Uh-huh. You don't usually have 3 years.
Totally.
No. You usually have, you're not supposed to have that much time. Mm-hmm. But I'm super lucky and I'm very thankful that I did have that opportunity because I'm very happy with, I'm very happy with where he is right now.
Mm-hmm. Would you say that, after that new layer of complexity, some of your own personality, your own traits have been given to the character?
Yeah, absolutely. Marty McFly is a 17-year-old kid. Mm-hmm. How do I play a 17-year-old kid? There are so many versions of what people think is a kid. Mm-hmm. So I decided to access my own teen self, to allow myself to get distracted, allow myself to pick things up and, look around. Teenagers are curious. They're curious about everything. And they're a bit more animated, giving that youthfulness to them, not so still. And I was just trying to access parts of me that I remember being young. Because essentially that's a version of a 17-year-old kid that, some people have never seen before. So I used that as opposed to studying 17-year-old kids. I just sort of recognized what it is in my life that I like that could be deemed as childish. I don't know. But I love watching cartoons. So for me, watching cartoons was a really easy way of finding mannerisms and physicality that I could maybe hopefully translate into the human world. You know, like double takes or, you know, a really quick shake of the head and high-pitched noises, low-pitched, playing around with it, creating this sort of wackadoodle thing going on with it. And then, naturally speaking, that all calms down and it all calms, instead of being this caricature, I sort of then honed in on it, made it focused, thought about the choices I was making, my intention in scenes. And yeah, I would just allow myself as a teenager to sometimes get distracted because it gives a sense of youthfulness. Yeah. And I'm talking a lot, but it was actually very important to me that I found a youthfulness to him.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want people thinking that that's an adult.
Yeah.
Playing a kid, you know.
I get it.
But thankfully, no one said that to you.
So, well, apart from, you know, all the demanding side that it has regarding the acting side, you know, to create this character, it's also an extremely technical show, and you in particular, but you're on stage almost all the time, and it has a lot of choreographies, a lot of, you know, very demanding scenes. So did you need any special preparation for this? Because it's extremely energetic and your acting is extremely energetic. So, you know, to be able to cope with almost 3 hours of show every night must not be easy.
I think the most important thing is managing the physical exhaustion, you know, so on a double show day, it's hard to be talking all the time in between shows. You know, that's just another layer of this is using me up. This is running the tank dry, you know, using the tank dry and all this sort of all that. And then if I were to tell you how I prepared for this role to do it 7 times a week, when I was in the workshops, I made sure that I was ready to sing 10 a.m. every single day. And this goes for rehearsals in Manchester and London. I never didn't go full out. So for me, it was about building stamina, building an association to what it is that it would do to me. So I would, you know, first day of workshops, 10 a.m. till 6 p.m., go all out all the time. Not only did I want to prove to them that, you know, I want this role, but with the 2 weeks I've got, I know it's going to be a lot because everyone knows the film, you know, he's in the film all the time. So I figured on stage, I would be on stage all the time as well. It was just about repetition, doing it over and over and over. Technically speaking, you know, when I do a lot of shouting, I would make sure that I'm in a place physically where I can exude that much energy, especially when you're shouting, because that can be quite detrimental to your singing voice as well. But I pride myself on technique, and you know, I had wonderful training when I was at college, so I didn't have to go back to any of those sorts of things. You know, I knew what to do. I know what to do. But in terms of building up stamina, that was the trickiest thing, and that kind of demanded me to do it full out every day. And then when we got to London, I was able to sit off the gas a bit, because I'd done it. I'd got there. I know what it is I need to do. And as I'm growing into this role and realizing being a lead, you can't actually always go full out. You know, there has to be moments where you rein it in for the sake of
your voice, yeah, and everything,
being able to do it.
Yeah.
But it's all about repetition. Not letting your mental self get to you going, oh, I can't do this, I can't do that. If you're already saying that, you're not going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it was about having self-belief and trusting in the processes of my technique and the want to do it. You know, I love this job and I think that helps too.
Apart from that, and also, you know, going, you know, saying it again that it's a very technical show, usually when shows are so technical, especially this one, which I'm not going to spoil it for everyone, but you know, those who go see it, just be prepared to be visually wowed. But usually, when something is so technical, bloopers happen. And I was wondering if you have had any funny bloopers that you would like to share with us.
I think directly with me, mm-hmm. the biggest blooper that happened was on the very first preview, the first preview in London. Mm-hmm. And I went to go do the guitar solo and the guitar strap just broke. And I was like, I was like, I can't hold a guitar up by just the neck. It's impossible. Mm-hmm. So that was a hard one. That was a bit iffy. That didn't feel great. I won't lie to you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've had a few issues with, you know, the car and random noises being played out during scenes where it's like, that's not supposed to happen for an hour. What's going on here? But in case I get told off by my bosses, I'm not going to say anymore.
How do you know, without spoiling anything for anyone, but have there been during the previews or even during the tryout in Manchester many changes to the show that may have affected you, to your character, or to the development of your scenes, or anything like that, or has it?
The biggest change would be the fact that the Manchester Opera House is a huge stage. Mm-hmm. Huge. It's a huge, huge stage. So the only change really mm-hmm. is set went from this to that.
To that. Okay. Yeah.
So blocking in scenes for me was a little bit different. But like I said previously, I took myself out of the job mm-hmm. after Manchester. Mm-hmm. So when I came back to London, I was very welcoming, and I think a lot of people were, of the changes that were going to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, because we weren't sitting waiting for it. If anything, I forgot what the set was like. It was a long time. It was a long, long time.
Brilliant. You know, to end this interview, if you would have to give me only one reason, one single reason to go see Back to the Future, apart from seeing you, of course, which one would it be?
So, you know, when you say to someone, oh, you should go and do this because the people that run it are really lovely people mm-hmm. and love what they do, you know, like say, you know, whenever I've been on holiday, I've had friends say to me, you should go to this lovely, quaint family restaurant because it's run by them and they love what it is that they do. Mm-hmm. And you usually end up having one of the best meals ever. The company here, the entire company, cast, crew, front of house, we all love this job. Mm-hmm. And I promise you that if you're anxious about your favorite film being ruined, it's not. We have treated these characters and the technical aspects with so much love and care that, you know, how do I explain this? This is a really hard question. It's like, we love the film as much as everyone else. Mm-hmm. We know what it means to everyone. And I just want everyone to know that the work and the amount of effort that came from everyone in this building to make sure that it was right was incredible. We pay massive amounts of respect to the film. That's what we know people want to see in a way. And plus the other side of things that you've never seen before. The reason you should come and see the show is because you will undoubtedly feel the love that has gone into the work on stage mm-hmm. in every aspect.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I must say that, you know, so many friends of mine that saw on my social media that I was attending the show were extremely jealous because they were all fans of the original movie. So I think that now they will come flocking to the theater, hopefully.
Yeah.
And well, Olly, thank you so much for such an amazing interview.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and well, break a leg on tonight's show.
Yeah, thank you very much.